Good morning. This is Sunday, the 10th of January, and welcome to Davidson's Mains Parish Church. My name is Sean and I am the community worker here at DMPC. We are not able to gather physically due to the change in restrictions, but we are thankful that we can still meet in this way, where we are together, yet scattered and safe. We're going to begin our service with worship this morning as we join together to sing, How Great Thou Art. Let's sing together. Well, Happy New Year to all of our young people. I always enjoy the new year because it feels like it's a new start. And it's also a bit weird because there's not really a huge difference between the 31st of December and the 1st of January. But it does feel like a good opportunity to start something new. Many people do New Year's resolutions where they say, this is the year where I do this or that. And some people, they're just glad to be out of the year they were in. And I know I've seen a fair few people who were glad to see 2020 end because of a lot of the bad things that it represents to them. But I just wanted to encourage you this morning that it's never too late for a fresh start. Maybe you feel like you've done too many bad things or thought too many bad thoughts for a fresh start. Too much for Jesus to save you. Too much to be loved by God. Well, there is nothing you can do to make God not love you. And the Bible is full of people who did many bad things in their lives, but asked God for a fresh start. King David had a man killed so he could steal his wife. The Apostle Paul, when he was called Saul, hunted down Christians to have them put in prison and put to death. And if they can get a fresh start, then so can you. And if you believe in Jesus and that he saves you from your sin, then he will. And the Bible says also that anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come. It's never too late. And even if you mess up, which you will, we all do, the chance of a fresh start is always there. Let's pray together for a moment. Jesus, we thank you that with you there is always a chance of a fresh start. No matter what we have done, if we are truly sorry, we know you will forgive us. Thank you for all our young people and their families. And we ask that you would be with them at this time, as they begin to try to balance work and homeschooling for a while. We thank you for the NHS and ask that you be with them as they serve those who are ill. And we pray for those who live alone and might be isolated in this time and ask that they would have people in place to help them through this new phase of lockdown. And would you provide opportunities for us to reach out to those who need it most. And hear us now as we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples, as we say together, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to sing together again. And this is one of the good things about us all being in our homes, is that we can sing together freely. And we're going to sing together now, O Church, Arise. Let's sing. And just one small announcement. Next Sunday, the 17th, immediately following the service, we are going to have a Zoom catch-up and cuppa. And we will send that link out to you in the update before next week. But next Sunday, 17th, after the service, I would love to see you, see your faces, hear how you're doing. So we'll see you then. We're going to be continuing our journey with Luke today. And today we're going to be reading from chapter 3, verses 1 through 20, which says this. In the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod, tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make paths straight for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked roads shall become straight, the rough ways smooth, and all people will see God's salvation. John said to the crowds coming out to be baptized by him, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. For I tell you that out of these stones God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is ready at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. What should we do then? The crowd asked. And John answered, anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none. And anyone who has food should do the same. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? Don't collect any more than you are required to, he told them. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn. But he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. But when John rebuked Herod the tetrarch because of his marriage to Herodias, his brother's wife, and all the other things he had done, Herod added this to them all. He locked John up in prison. Amen. So last week, Derek talked to us about the story of Jesus as a boy, teaching in the temple, his father's house, while Mary and Joseph searched for him. And this week, the story changes focus from Jesus to his cousin, John, also known as John the Baptist or John the Baptizer. The passage begins by telling us when this particular part of the story is set. And ancient dating methods employed the use of governing leaders as reference points. So it says, in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod, tetrarch of Galilee, his brother Philip, tetrarch of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, tetrarch of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of the Lord came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. In verse 2, Luke mentions some religious personalities. Annas was the high priest in Israel until AD 15. And while the people still held Annas in high regard and treated him as the high priest, his son-in-law Caiaphas was the official high priest from AD 18 to 36. In the Old Testament, the ministry of prophets was dated alongside governing kings. And in preparing to introduce John the Baptist, Luke dates John's ministry in relation to current rulers to demonstrate that John was a prophet of God. 2b says, the word of God came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. John the Baptist lived in solitude in the wilderness for 34 years. And at the right time, the word of God came to John. This means that God revealed his will to John. God called him to be a prophet, and God gave him the message which he was to proclaim. And God didn't tell John everything, only that which John needed to proclaim. And we'll see in this passage and the rest of the gospel that John did not know that Jesus was God. He simply knew and proclaimed Jesus as Israel's Messiah. It says, he went into all the country around the Jordan, preaching a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. What is repentance? Well, the word repentance comes from the Greek term metanoia, which literally means to change your mind, to turn around, but not merely a change of mind, but a change of heart. This repentance was for the forgiveness of sins. The Bible tells us that all have fallen short of God's glorious standard, and only through the one who John was preaching about could sins be forgiven, which we know now to be Jesus. And baptism itself is the outward sign of an inward reality. I was baptized by full immersion, or being dunked. Maybe you were too. And what that symbolizes for us as Christians, being put under the water, like Jesus being put in the tomb, and then rising again out of the water, like Jesus rising from the dead. Another way to look at it that I like is from Exodus, the people of God fleeing slavery, and they go down into the water of the Red Sea, which has been parted, and they come out the other side into freedom and new life. John called the nation of Israel to repent of their sins. And those who truly repented anticipated the removal of the sins through Messiah. And they gave their testimony to the fact of their repentance by participating in John's baptism. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight paths for him. Every valley shall be filled in, every mountain and hill made low. The crooked road shall become straight, the rough ways smooth. And all people will see God's salvation. When ancient kings travelled in the desert, workmen preceded them to clear debris and smooth out the roads to make travel smoother. Isaiah's passage uses hyperbolic language. Not only are the rocks cleared out the way, but valleys are filled in and mountains are removed. And this metaphoric language is descriptive of repentance. The people of God are preparing for God's arrival through repentance, preparing their hearts for his arrival. And this passage continues the theme of the universal offer of salvation through the Messiah. All people does not mean that all people without exception will be saved, but that all people are eligible. All lives have been bought through the blood of Christ. And Luke shows in this passage that John the Baptist's ministry was to prepare Israel for the Messiah by calling them to repent of their sins. They would only be prepared for this offer of the kingdom if they repented of their sins, only by being born again. And those who truly repented would receive the removal of their sins. They would give testimony of their repentance through water baptism. So we move on. And John says to the crowds coming to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath?" And to us that might seem strange. How many times have you witnessed a pastor rebuking people for responding to his message? But John saw that some of these people were not genuine. And he goes on, "Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham." John was not commanding them to make themselves repentant. He was commanding them to demonstrate fruit worthy of repentance. True repentance will be demonstrated in a person's life. In essence, John was saying, if you have actually repented of your sins, there should be a visible demonstration of a spiritual reality. Performing good works does not mean a person is repentant, but one who repents of his sin will demonstrate this through outward change and good works. The Israelites mistakenly thought their ancestry from Abraham was their ticket to paradise. They thought that they would automatically enter God's kingdom on earth. However, John showed them that religious heritage or Jewish ancestry would not be enough to save them. The passage goes on. "The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire." And this was the warning to those who thought their heritage alone would save them. "What shall we do then?" the crowd asked. John answered, "Anyone who has two shirts should share with the one who has none, and anyone who has food should do the same." In order to understand this command, it's important to understand that Israel was under the Mosaic law, which was given to Israel as their national constitution. And it not only contained their religious duties, but their civic obligations as well. The law told them how to live as God's chosen nation. And it included laws to help Israel care for the destitute. Israel was responsible to care for the poor within the nation. However, because the nation fell away from God, it did not keep the Mosaic law with all its regulations, which included how to care for the poor. Repentance would cause the Jews to return to God, which would be demonstrated by obedience to the law, specifically caring for the less fortunate. Even tax collectors came to be baptized. "Teacher," they asked, "what should we do?" "Don't collect any more than you're required to." In response to John the Baptist's strong rebuke, even the tax collectors who had come to be baptized by him hesitated because of John's demands. Their hesitation is demonstrated by the fact they asked John how repentance would affect them. And John replies, "Don't collect any more than you're required to." If the tax collectors were truly repentant, they would care for others and they would not defraud others by over-collecting. Then some soldiers asked him, "And what should we do?" He replied. "Don't extort the money and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay." The soldiers were told not to abuse authority. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor, and to gather the wheat into his barn. He will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. John emphasized the fact that his water baptism did not confer any spiritual power upon those who were immersed. Being dipped underwater cannot change anyone. John goes on to say, "One who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie." And this is a clear reference to the coming of the Messiah, Jesus. And John used an analogy to explain his role in relation to Jesus's. You know, a servant was responsible to take off his master's sandals and to wash his feet. And even though John the Baptist did not yet know who the Messiah was, he knew that he would be far greater than he is. In fact, John the Baptist placed himself even lower than a servant, that he wasn't even worthy to untie the Messiah's sandal straps. John described Jesus' first baptizing work when he said, "He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." This is a reference to the saving work of Jesus Christ, because those who receive Jesus receive the Holy Spirit. Jesus is also the winnower who is going to separate the wheat from the chaff. So the imagery clearly shows us that Jesus will divide all people into two groups. We are told that Jesus will gather the wheat into his barn. The wheat represents those who respond in faith to Jesus. They are gathered into his barn, an allusion to his kingdom. However, the chaff will burn with unquenchable fire. Chaff is the useless part of the grain, and it represents those who would not respond in faith to Christ. And the passage concludes, "And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. But when John rebuked Herod the Tetrarch because of his marriage to Herodias, his brother's wife, and all the other evil things he had done, Herod added this to them all. He locked John up in prison." The imprisonment of John actually took place later in the gospel narratives. Luke mentions his imprisonment to show how Herod responded to God's message as delivered by John. And what stands out in this passage is the humility and obedience of John the Baptist. John had little regard for himself and knew that God was using him to prepare for the one coming who was far greater than he. And he willingly and joyfully fulfilled God's will in his life. However, John the Baptist was imprisoned and eventually killed. Believers have the responsibility to follow God and to proclaim God's glory to those who are lost. However, though believers may understand, believe, and declare God's truth to others, it does not guarantee that others will embrace the message. Obedience does not translate into a carefree life. Some will respond and repent, others will reject the message. In these hard times, the world needs hope more than ever. And there is only one who can really bring hope, and that is Jesus. So how can we be sharing this hope? How can we be extending the hand of friendship? How can we be making Jesus known in these dark days? We're about to listen to a song for reflection. But before that, let's pray together. Thank you, God, for people like John, who were faithful in proclaiming your coming, and for those who have proclaimed your good news since. Thank you for that good news, that you died for us on the cross, and in because of that, we can repent, we can turn our hearts towards you and be forgiven of our sin. Help us now to proclaim you to the world. Help us to have conversations that glorify you. Help us to build strong relationships where you would be made known. And help us to live our whole lives, everything we do, in response to what you have done for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's listen to this reflection.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart, yeah. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus.
All about you.
Heart. into my heart. I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song. Yeah. I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song.
Well, thank you so much for joining us this week. We'll be back next week with Dan on the next part of Luke's Gospel. But until then, we are praying for you and we love you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.